Let me admit everyone. All right. Good to see so many people interested in OD and change management. I think the last semester there were just 5 of them. Hopefully you people stay in this paper, not move to the other paper. No, you take your decision. I don't want to influence your decision making. All right. Okay, let's start. Okay, good afternoon and welcome once again to all of you. Thank you for choosing this paper because you had a choice to choice of two papers, and you chose this paper, OD and Change Management. Rajiv Kurulkar, let me admit him. All right. Okay. And this is not the first time we are starting the program on time. So this will happen 6 more times. So we will start dot on time. So I would request everyone to join little before time, so that we start exactly at 2 o'clock. All right. So since this is the first class, some introductions are in order. So let me start with myself. My name is Ajay. I'm Ajay Kumar Sahu. I'm the founder and director of a consulting firm. Its name is IRHS. IRHS stands for Interior Resource Human Solutions LLP. It's a French name. When I started this consulting firm in 2016, I was a little too late for the English names because they were all taken. So I had to settle for a French name, which is IRHS, actually stands for Impactful HR Human Resource Solutions. So I'm not from France or anything to do with France, but that's how it just turned out. All right. So this firm was started in 2016, and we are a Delhi-based boutique firm. We are into management and HR consulting, and our client base is it spans the entire India. So we have all India footprint. And we basically specialize in certain areas, not all, certain areas of HR. Like, we do a lot of work in campus to corporate, soft skills. We do a lot of work in mentoring, work on ACDC, Assessment Center, Development Center, change management, culture change. These are some of the OD interventions we have done for our clients. And of course, certain training programs. And I love teaching. So apart from the diploma program for ISTT, I also teach the students of TIS, Tata Institute of Social Sciences. I have been taking their PG diploma classes ever since 2017. So I've done around 7-8 batches so far. And I also teach MBA students from IIM Raipur, IIT Roorkee, IIT BHU. That's what I do when I'm not consulting. So before I started this company, consulting firm, I was the global group HR head for a couple of groups in Dubai. The groups were Aldoboy and Zenesis. Both are into manufacturing premium tires. So we used to manufacture our tires in China, in the Shandong province of China, and we used to sell these tires in the geographies, like MENA region, that is Middle East and North Africa, South Africa, Europe. So we had employees from almost 29 different nationalities, including Pakistanis. And before that, I was in India. I was with 4 different companies in my 36 years of career. I was with Lanco Infratech. It's an all-India infrastructure company. I was with a Belgian multinational called Eternit Everest. They are into building materials. I was with a company called Daewoo Motors. The guys who brought in such iconic cars like Cielo and Matiz. And they were the first actually to bring in $1 billion investment into India in early 90s. And I started my career with a power major, NTPC Limited. I started as a management trainee with them way back in 1984. Most of you were not born at that point of time. And yes, as I said, I love teaching, and I teach MBA students of IIT, IIM Raipur, TISS, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, IIT Roorkee, and IIT BHU. And I am also a visiting faculty for KITS, Bhubaneswar, and GIMS, Delhi, and a couple of other MBA institutes in Noida and Greater Noida. And I hold a MBA degree from FMS, Faculty of Management Studies, Delhi. And I also hold a master's degree from JNU. So that's about me. All right, so let's know a little bit about who is in this class, right? So hang on. Oh, good. A lot of people are joining in. That's really good. So what I want is, since this is the first class, let's get to know each other better. Don't worry, we will complete our course in time for you to prepare for your exams. So no worries on that. In the first class, let's hear who is who and who has joined this class. All right, anybody would like to start?
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, Anupam.
I am Brigadier Anupam Sharma, currently a serving Army officer, currently posted in Army War College at Mau. Here my assignment is teaching. I am teaching tactical and operational issues to the budding commanding officers of the Indian Army. Teaching is one of my passions, and hopefully in near future when I hang my uniform, I will probably graduate into that.
All right. Great. Welcome, Brigadier. Thank you so much. All right. Anybody else? Okay, Rajnikant, I have just admitted. Okay, good. All right, guys.
Sir, good afternoon. My name is Parveen Vasist. I'm a mechanical engineer. And for last 18 years, I'm working into sales and marketing. I have worked with some multinational companies which are dealing mainly in construction products. Like I used to sell glass, I used to sell gypsum board, I used to sell elevators and escalators, and presently I am selling plywood. So right. It's my passion. I think that training and development is the thing who has shaped my career well, and I'm doing well in sales.
Right, thank you Parveen. Okay, Rajnikant has raised his hand. Rajnikant, you want to go next? All right, no worries. Anybody else would like to go next?
Yes, sir, I'm Ritu Desai. Thanks for this opportunity, because International Women's Day is near. So it's good to speak out who I am. I'm a very creative individual and working in pharmaceutical industry. Yeah. As a sales professional since long, almost 17 years crossed. But I have a deep desire and a deep ability in terms of teaching aptitude. So always try to push myself in this. I know I want to become a successful trainer or something with teaching arena. So this is my whole self. Aspire to become a good individual in terms of serving society with teaching as my strength.
Lovely.
So this is all.
Thanks, Ritu. Thanks, Atta. Yeah. Anybody else? Rajiv. Yeah. Okay. Great. So we still have 4 minutes time for introduction from your side.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, good afternoon. This is Kinshuk Sinha this side.
Yeah. Yes, Kinshuk.
Yeah, I carry an experience of around 7 years into teaching.
Yeah.
I was with a university called as Invertis University Bareilly.
Okay.
I taught BBA, MBA, and I also took care of the operational issues in terms of their placements.
Right.
So teaching is a passion as such, hence ISTD. I want to go ahead and the bug actually caught me there.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, why not to enhance myself into T&D full force?
Great. Thanks, Gengshu. I think we have spoken.
We have chatted before. Earlier also.
We have chatted. Right. Yeah. I think I have chatted with Anupam also before.
Correct.
Is it Brigadier? Yeah. Right. Yeah. Good. Thank you. Yeah, all right. Thanks. Anybody else?
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Rashmi Modak. I work in the learning and development department in a software company called Exact. And
which company, Rashmi?
It's called Exact.
Exact.
Yeah, Exact yeah. Incorporated. So, okay. I was, the course was recommended to me by my manager, and I'm really enjoying myself.
Right, Rashmi. Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you.
Right. Yes, guys, you still have 2 minutes to introduce yourself.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
This is Sudhir here. Good afternoon to all my colleagues also. My name is Sudhir. I'm part of the learning and OD team with a pharmaceutical company in Bombay.
Yeah.
I started my career way back in 2000, but with sales, but then shifted into training because I preferred the other side of the job. I also done my different training courses, the last being a coaching certificate from ICF.
Okay. So you are a coach?
Yes, sir.
You completed your 100 hours?
Yes.
Oh, great. So you are an ACC now, is it?
Yeah.
Lovely. Right. Great. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Right. Okay.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
This is Shalini.
Yes, Shalini.
By profession, sir, I'm a banker.
Yeah.
Really want to go into this field, this training and development.
Yeah.
So this is a new field for me.
Oh, lovely. Okay, good. So HR is totally new to you, right?
Yeah.
Okay, good. All right. One more minute for introductions from the students. Anybody would like to grab this opportunity? Your time in the sun? Or is it too hot nowadays? All right.
Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, this is Arvind here. I am actually from a software services background, around 16 years of experience in India and abroad. And I'm passionate about learning, development, and training. Though I haven't worked any time in training or any sort of teaching experience, but because I am from the services domain, I wanted to, see how training and development in India can be automated. And primarily, this is the reason why it actually, draw my interest to know the deeper side of training and development.
Great. Thank you. Welcome, Arvind. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Okay. So here is the course outline as is given in your syllabus. Okay, Sarika, let me admit first. Okay, all right. So this is what your syllabus says. What is organization development? Models of organization development. When to use OD, and also from the change management side, we are going to cover what is change management, steps and models of change management, and course review. So that we will do on the in the seventh session, right? So we'll cover all our syllabus in the five sessions. The sixth session, I plan to have a quiz, if not earlier. And seventh session, we would do a course overview. That's my plan is. Okay. So let's capture your expectations. Some of you are new to this field, HR. Some of you are in HR and L&D, but you have chosen OD, right? As against say talent management, which was available to you, or maybe you want to attend one class and maybe you want to decide which one you want to go for, right? So what actually goaded you into considering OD and change management, and what do you want? What are your expectations out of these six, seven sessions or out of this paper? Why OD? What is it that you want to take away? And please give your name so that we know who you are and what your expectations are. And so that we capture your expectations, and going forward, possibly we would try to address your expectations as well when we design this course accordingly for you. All right, go ahead.
Yeah, so this is Arvind here. Good afternoon, everyone. Basically, when I think about OD, I think about change, and change is inevitable, be it industry, anything we think about. And hence, I believe OD is very important for all of us to understand change and how to transform and how to put that transformation in working as to, you know, deal with that change. I would actually like to learn what OD is all about, how to create proper OD interventions, and really how to be an OD expert, because if I'm going to be in consulting, OD is primarily going to be very important for me, I guess. So that's my, you know, primary take when I think about OD.
Sure. Thanks, Arvind. Thanks. Okay. Anybody else?
If I have been allowed, Ritu here.
Yeah, Ritu.
To me, organizational development is definitely a deep desire for any business unit. So yeah. I want to venture into this business world with a differentiation. And I think this is a key. If I have a courage and candor and the specialty, I am a specialist of this change management, I would bring that change and development in the organization. So this is probably an important tool, though change management is there in us, we know, but then on a big picture of organization, what are the nuances and how I can be a specialist? So that is, of course, same as Arvind, expert of that.
Okay. Sir, this is Anupam.
Hello?
Yes?
Yeah, Anupam, you want to go first, okay.
As far as any organization is concerned, an organization has to continuously keep evolving.
Yeah.
Evolution has got to take place with the technological changes that are taking place, with the HR challenges that are going to come up, mm-hmm. and so on. You can keep going on and keep listing out these changes. And only nimble organizations survive the changes that are going to happen in the world, whether it is business world or any field. Only nimble organizations will survive.
Sure.
OD is the one which enables you to see what are the changes that are taking place and imbibe those changes into the organization so that the organization survives and prospers. The biggest example that comes to mind is of the Kodak, from being the biggest manufacturer of the paper-based those photo films.
Yeah.
They went into oblivion the moment digital photography came into being. Sure. They couldn't survive the change because they had not invested into the change management as far as their organization was concerned.
Sure. Yeah. Right. Thanks. Thanks, Anupam.
Sir, actually, I want to understand, is this OD can be applied?
Who is this?
Sir, my name is Parveen Vashist.
Yeah.
I'm dealing with lots of small companies or small organizations.
Yeah.
So I want to explore those small organizations are suitable for OD or not. Is OD will be helpful to make them big? Because not small organizations, I am finding that most of them are saturated on, say, 10 crore or 20 crore turnover. And very few becomes of 100 crore or 1,000 crores. So can I do something to make them big by using OD?
Okay. Yeah, right. Okay, let me just admit Priyanka. Okay, right. Okay, go ahead. Yeah, anybody else?
Sir, Kinshuk this side.
Yes, Kinshuk.
So for me, OD is a sort of an understanding the entire organics of how an organization functions. Now, for example, there are many, there's a purchase department, there's a sales department, there are many other departments that have got their own bylaws and laws and how they function. So it's an overview of things that we have a perspective of the horizon. Like every other, the basic template is same. But every other organization, whether it be IT, whether it be hotel, whether it be education, whether it be manufacturing, every other particular organization has got its own dynamics. So sure. Having a perspective towards it makes me a better person to work for that organization as such.
Right. Okay. Right. Thanks, Kanchu. Anybody else who would like to have a go? Good afternoon, Rashmi.
Yes. So, my expectations are to learn what OD is. I'm not an HR professional by training. I got into HR out of interest.
Yeah.
So my expectation is definitely to learn more about OD because when I did some research and talked to my peers group, it was very closely related to L&D. And so it just made sense for me to choose OD.
Sure. Okay. Right. Thanks, Rashmi. Thanks.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Shivani.
My expectation is I want to know that generally when it comes to organizational development and change management, it's generally related to top management. But how being in mid-level management, we can contribute to organizational development and change management is my expectation. I want to know more about it.
Okay, right, good. Thank you. Thank you, Shivani. Okay. Anybody else?
Sir, Priyanka this side.
Yes, Priyanka.
Sir, I want to understand, like, my expectation would be, like, being a learning and development professional, how I can help the organization, or I would say the people who are there in organization, how I can enable them to accept this and how they can contribute towards this organization development and this thing. Okay. So this is what my expectation is, to learn from the view of a L&D professional, because I'm into that only. So that is what my expectation is.
So there's a last slot which is up for grabs. No, I was joking. You can add more. Anybody else?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, Dr. Ketan Dholakia from Ahmedabad.
Dr. Ketan
Dholakia.
Okay.
as I understand, it starts from conception of the conception and birth of the organization to maintenance and survival, and including revival, all ideas for all these things, it will be included in that.
Okay, all right. Okay. All right, so let's let me save this. Okay, so these were the expectations which we had captured in the last, hang on, let me just clear the annotation. So these were the expectations which were captured from the students from the last batch, right? Have a look at this. So they, I believe quite a few of your expectations are matching this. Learn the concepts with practical examples. They wanted a few case studies of OD interventions and how OD can be aligned with L&D, relationship between OD, training analytics, and return on investment, overlap of OD and change management, whether they are entirely different or there is overlap. They wanted to know how to develop a structured approach for change management and why OD is such a hot thing, right? And of course, to learn from others about the latest in the field, right? Okay. So these were their expectations. All right, so now that we have your expectations on our belt, let's generate some ground rules or the house rules as to how we would like to proceed and how would you like to behave ourselves. I mean, that includes me, all right? So see, I'm not a dictator. So I will go exactly as per what ground rules you set for yourselves. So there are no ground rules which I'm going to give it to you. So the definition of integrity is doing what you say you are doing, right? So you tell me what all ground rules you would like to adhere. If you say you want to come half an hour late, I'll put it here, and that's not an issue, right? As long as you come half an hour late, I'm okay. Right, so what are the ground rules you want to play by for the next 7 classes?
Yeah. Punctuality, sir.
Punctuality, right. Yeah.
Participation.
I'm
participation.
Sorry? Very good.
Sir, participation.
Okay. Participation. What else?
Sir, discipline from everyone, that no, if someone is not speaking, they should mute their mic and not let the background noise disturb others. Additionally, I would also request, if it is possible, that if the chat is also enabled, it actually gives a lot of leverage to people who are not able to, you know, speak up, because there are people who might have network challenges, and it is easier for them to type in and send their questions in some cases.
Right. Yeah, that's a good suggestion. I'll ask the IT to enable the chat.
Thank you.
Right. Okay. All right. Any other? So, Arbin, by discipline, you meant what? Only people should not speak out of turn or any other things?
Discipline means we should respect, like if someone is speaking, we should not intercept.
Yeah,
or
yeah.
Like if I'm not speaking, I should put my microphone on mute so that my background noise should not disturb others. We all understand the basic discipline, sir, within a session. So
I know. You people are mature people.
Yeah.
And,
so
yeah. Sure. Okay. All right. Good.
Thanks.
What else? You don't want to set any rules for yourself, right? We are what? 29 people, right?
Sir, all the basic session rules already applies to all of us. So like people said that we have to be punctual. They should come on time.
Yeah, punctuality has come. Participation has come.
Participation has come.
Right. Yeah. Right. And what do you do to your mobile phone? Unless you are attending this class on your mobile phone. Yeah, so put your mobile phones on silent. And, yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Good. All right. So, yeah, anybody?
So one more rule from my side. I mean, it should be from your side rather.
Right.
Yeah, that all the classes should be uploaded on time.
Classes mean the videos?
Yeah, the videos should be uploaded on time on YouTube. I mean, that was the format that we were in, right?
Yeah. So that I'll tell our IT to do the network. Yeah, good. And also from my side, we may create a separate WhatsApp group where I would be sharing the PPTs, which I would be using every session. So that much I can do. All right. Okay. So, all right. So moving on. So these were the house rules which the previous class had set for themselves. Let's be participative. Use the chat box. So these two have come already from two of you. Let's give, receive constructive feedback. Let's be punctual. Let's be positive and open-minded. Let us keep all electronic devices muted. Let us respect all viewpoints, even if we disagree. Let us share from our experience. Yeah, participation. Let us allow everyone to speak, participate. Let us come prepared to the class. Yeah, all right. Okay, rather than just coming to walk in a park, you would hopefully go through the PPTs which we have done in the previous class, and also any other readings which I might have suggested to you, right? So these are the ground rules which were there in the previous class. All right. Okay, so in fact, what we will do is, unless you know about change management, OD change management can be for a certain section of the organization. Whereas organization development actually it encompasses the entire organization. So so let's not put the cart before the horse. So we will we'll be dealing with change management first, and then we'll move on to the organization development. So that's a simple tweak I'm doing for your syllabus, but. Yes, we will cover both in the next 6-7 classes. Okay. All right, let's start. Let's start with the VUCA world, right? So you people know about the VUCA world, I'm sure, right? So anybody would like to comment on the term VUCA? Of course, the it's an acronym, and the what it stands for is there at the bottom of your screen, but still, anybody would like to comment on it and tell us more about what it is, and maybe from your own experience. What's a VUCA word? VUCA, of course, stands for volatility, uncertainty, complexity, ambiguity.
Sir, basically, when we talk about VUCA, this term acronym, it was found during the COVID time and it became very popular also. This was the first time when things were uncertainty was actually it spread on a very large scale. Nobody knew what is going to happen tomorrow. It actually affected the mass at the greatest level. And people across the globe, they started with different sort of transformation, different types of changes started happening at different levels to ensure that the continuity of business, the continuity of life remains. We still are going through this VUCA phase. Uncertainty is still persisting. The ambiguity, complexity, and things are still a lot of, I mean, there are few vaccines which have come up, but still life is very volatile. I have seen, you know, a lot of people who are fit and fine today, and, you know, a few days later, we find that, you know, the same person, he passed away, or there was some challenge in his home or her home. Going forward, this COVID, or especially this VUCA, it taught us to be strong, and it actually taught us to be more resilient, and it taught us how to, use the change management in our life, in day-to-day life. Right. So basically, when we talk about OD, OD is not only related to organization. I think it also largely affects our life also. As a entity, as a family also, we can use the nitty-gritties of OD to make things better, because our life also involves a lot of changes at each level.
Right. Okay. Thanks, sir. Thanks, Arvind. Okay. Anybody else?
So VUCA is something which has been used in armed forces for a very long time now.
Right.
VUCA is something which has come up because of the rapid technological changes and its military adaptation that has been taking place, as well as the doctrinal changes that have taken place. Just to quote a few examples, the range of the weapon systems has increased manifolds. The accuracy of the weapon systems has increased manifold.
Right.
It means that only it is not only the frontline soldiers who are at a threat. Even someone 100 kilometers to the rear or 200 kilometers to the rear, as much at a threat. So that creates a new dynamic, an uncertain and a complex dynamic.
Yeah.
It came about the doctrinal changes that have taken place, maybe some sponsored through Al-Qaeda and the terrorism kind of a thing. When suddenly your foe was not wearing a uniform, it could be anyone. You walk into a bazaar, you don't know who's a friend, who's a foe. So that's how the management of that change became a very, very complex issue. Now the same thing over a period of time has permeated into the business world also, with especially with the COVID. Probably COVID has only exacerbated the problem. It has not created the problem. The problem has had started coming up, but it only exacerbated the problem of an uncertain and a complex environment. Far too many ambiguities which are to be dealt with. Things change extremely rapidly. All those issues now have to be taken into consideration, which takes me back to my previous point, that organizations and the managers who are working out for the organizations need to be very nimble, need to be adaptive, and need to be able to take decisions very quickly.
Sure. Thanks. Thanks, Brigadier Anupam. Anupam, I'll just take you on that since you are in the, you actually teach tactical warfare, right, in Mao. So you must have either read or heard about a book called The Art of War by Sun Tzu, right?
Yes.
Okay. So that was what, around 2000 years back or 2500
yes,
years back?
Yes, around 2500 years back.
Correct. So the time when Sun Tzu wrote that book, The Art of War, then come forward to the First and Second World War and come further forward to the present day, right? How has the warfare changed And how would you relate the VUCA to these three scenarios?
So the way the, yes, Sun Tzu wrote this about a little over 2000 years back.
Yeah.
But at the same point in time, if you read what was written by Chanakya in the Arthashastra, is a treatise on both war fighting as well as management of a kingdom. Whereas Sun Tzu, Art of War, is only on the basic issues of how a war must be fought and the various
mechanics. Right.
Now, to come back to the question that you had raised, over a period of time, the way we move forward, the first generation of war, the second generation of war, the third and the fourth generation of war, the way things changed were because of the weapon systems that were in use at varying points in time. The first generation of war was, actually there is some little ambiguity on the first generation of war. Some call the open flank warfare when the two armies used to mass against each other as the first generation of war. There are some who call the trench warfare that took place during the First World War as the first generation of war, wherein you had trenches that were dug in, people took position in those trenches, there were huge artillery barrages, but you had to physically assault the trenches. Then the warfare, this is the one in which there were mass casualties. Millions died in the First World War in trying to assault each other.
Yeah.
Then we came on to the mechanized warfare, when the tanks made their introduction into the sphere of warfare.
Sure.
You had an armored carrier in which the troops move forward. It suddenly eliminated the necessity of the trenches, or trenches became redundant. That became the next generation of warfare. The third generation came in when we had the aerial elements. That is, the aircrafts made their appearance into the warfare. Along with the aircrafts, you had the other aerial means like missiles, which could strike you long distances, which made appearance. So these were the first three generations of the war. The fourth generation of war is where the terrorists made their appearance. In this, the distinction between the frontline and the rear, the distinction between a warrior and a civilian all but disappeared. The next two generations are already being talked about, the fifth and the sixth generation warfare. This is the hybrid warfare where everything will get coalesced into war fighting. Whether it is you and me sitting here, where a civilian will become as important a war fighting component as the other one. This will also include the cyber and the space as the new zones of war. So this is how the warfare has...
Dheeru, can you mute yourself if you don't mind? Thank you.
And in changing with these technological changes, in accordance with these technological changes that were taking place, then the strategies also changed. And with more and more technology coming in, more and more uncertainty also came in as far as the war fighting was concerned. So the OODA loops, what we call the OODA loop, observe, orient, decide, and act, that OODA loop became shorter and shorter with more complexities coming in.
Sure. Thanks, Anupam. In fact, Sun Tzu, he famously said that you win the war twice. Right? Once you win the war in your head, and second time you win the war on the battlefield. Similarly, in War and Peace of Leo Tolstoy, he also talks about this very concept that you win the war twice, once in your head, the other times, other occasion you win it on the battlefield. In fact, if you don't win the war in your head, which means your strategy and tactics are not proper, then you are bound to lose the physical war on the battlefield. Right. So does that hold true in the VUCA world? If not, why not?
Come again, sir, please.
I said, when Sun Tzu said that you must win the war twice, once in your head and the second time in the battlefield, right? So that he was addressing a very settled world with settled warfare implements and tactics which were available, say, 2,000 years back. And the same thing held good when Napoleon was fighting his war, right? But does that hold good even today in the VUCA world? If not, absolutely. Why not?
Absolutely, sir. It holds good even today. Today, mm-hmm. will be fought in three domains, primarily physical sure. domain, the informational yeah. domain, and the cognitive domain. Okay. And cognitive domain is actually the most important of the three. If you have won the war in your head, and if the enemy has lost the war in his head, the physical war is only a matter of time.
Yeah, yeah. And also, not only you'll have to win the war in your head, but you have to win the war in various scenarios, right? So the game theory comes into being. Like, what could be? There could not be just one scenario. There could be, say, several scenarios. So you have to win the war in your head, given various scenarios, right? Scenario 1, 2, 3. And if you don't do that, if you have won the war in scenario 1 in your head, and the scenario 2 comes about, then you have lost the war, right? Okay. Now, I'll take up Arvind when he talked about VUCA and linked it to COVID-19, right? So either Arvind himself can answer this, or some of you also can answer. I want you to link each of the four letters: volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, separately to COVID-19. Yeah, so each one can take up one. How did COVID-19 make the world volatile? How did it, so the second person can take up how it made it uncertain, right? Volatile is what? Something which is incendiary, which can catch fire. That's what the meaning is, right? So how does it work? The reason why I am persisting with this is it's very intimately linked to both OD and change management. One must understand what actually triggers the OD intervention, what actually triggers the change management initiative. So unless we are very clear as to the cause, I mean, it's called a primogenitor of OD intervention or a change management. Unless you know why you are undertaking OD intervention, why you are undertaking a change management, then it's not going to succeed. If you are going for an OD intervention because it is a fad, because your top management or your chairman happened to read a book on a particular topic, and during his flight to your Mumbai headquarters, and he comes and tells you that let's go for this, let's go for, say, TQM, or let's go for say HR analytics. So if it is just a fad, then it's different. But if it is because of a particular situation in which the organization finds itself, and it wants to address that situation, then the OD intervention or change management initiative would be much more successful. That's why I'm persisting on this slide. Yeah, go ahead. You understood my question?
Yes, yes. So when we try to link the four letters, VUCA, VUCA, with COVID time, we have seen how fast scenarios were changing during the COVID period.
You are addressing the first letter, right?
Yeah, volatility.
Okay.
During the COVID times, we have seen that something that prevailed today will not stand tomorrow. Something which holds good today will not hold good tomorrow. And we do not know if, you know, day after tomorrow again, what we hold tomorrow will hold good day after tomorrow. So things were changing at a very fast pace. It means it actually made things very volatile. reliability on things that we have been practicing for a long time may not work completely or partially, and we actually can fail with the approaches that have been taken earlier in our life. So we have to keep changing at a very fast pace. And this is what we actually meant, that the time became very volatile.
Yeah. Okay, right. Thanks. Thanks, Arvind. Anupam, can you just mute yourself if you don't mind? Thank you. All right. Okay.
My apologies, sir.
No issues. All right. Anybody would like to take up the next letter, uncertainty, and link it to COVID-19 or any other situation you can think of?
Sir, Kinshuk here?
Yes, Kinshuk.
The second letter, uncertainty, I mean, a simple line,
yeah,
stating that the future is uncertain. We try to think that what we have and what we want to reach or we want to do. The COVID times are still in this particular phase of uncertainty, that how it is going to help. I mean, as human civilization as a whole, the entire Earth, entire globe is into a very uncertain phase. That not even businesses, but as generic lives, that uncertainty is like a guillotine in our head, that we are certainly uncertain that how it will turn the DNA structure of a particular human being or the future to come and what would happen. When it came, everything was uncertain. We were ramshackled. We were not in the right minds.
Right.
Very gradually, we picked up. For taking an example, I mean, ISTD as such, I call my batch the COVID batch. Because two physical classes were promised and we were not there. We were highly uncertain about how things are going to change.
Yeah.
Zoom came into picture. Uncertainty was there, that how we would take classes, like you are taking. We are physically apart, but we are here. So that is my take on this particular part of the uncertainty word.
Right. Thanks, Kingshul. Kingshul, don't go now. Would you also try and distinguish between uncertainty and ambiguity? Are they same, or they are interchangeable words, or they're different?
So more or less.
Sir, can I add?
Yeah. Who is this? Let
my name is Praveen Vishist. Okay, no problem.
Yeah.
So more or less, if you take my take, it is as such that all the four particular words are quite similar in nature, where you can use them interchangeably.
Okay.
You rightly stated that uncertainty and ambiguity is one of the same thing, but how do you perceive it? That is more important.
Right. Yeah, Praveen.
It's rightly said. Ambiguity is basically uncertainty, or how you interpret it, basically. So one situation can be interpreted differently by two different people. So ambiguity is basically not having a clear, like 2 + 2 is equal to 4. It's very clear, sir. But when we talk about a general situation, it cannot be very clearly defined, and two person can take away different interventions. They can intervene as per their convenience. And then uncertainty, we know that's it, sir, which is like future, which is uncertain.
Okay. Anybody else? Is uncertainty and ambiguity same or different? And if different, how different?
There is a subtle difference between the two words, the uncertainty and ambiguity.
Yeah.
Uncertainty means that you are not sure as to what is going to happen.
Okay.
There is no guarantee. You are out of your comfort zone. You don't know what is going to happen next. Something what COVID did to us.
Yeah.
Ambiguity means that you have more than one option that is available, and you don't know which is the correct option or what is to be chosen. There are definitely options available, which are more than one, and you now have to make a choice. Whereas in uncertainty, you don't know what is the option that is available. So that is a subtle difference between the two words.
Okay, right. Thanks. Okay, now coming to the next word, complexity. Who would like to take up that word?
Hello.
Yes, Mr.
Dev. Yeah. Complexity means from prior to COVID, almost all the thing was going offline only.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, even training, even business. Now it is online, and after COVID is over, it will be mixed. It will be online, offline, at per suitability.
Why should it be complex? More complex than physical.
Formally, because physically, everything is all under control. As for training, classroom training, we know each other, we know each other's expectation by physical in a physical way.
Mm-hmm.
Online, it is not possible up to that level. Yeah, certain barriers are also there.
Sure. Okay. Right.
The complexity in this COVID, I would take it from my example.
Yeah.
How I experienced COVID. I was the nodal officer for the armed forces,
mm-hmm.
in the national government in the COVID management.
Okay.
When the first flight came in from Wuhan's,
mm-hmm.
first Air Force aircraft which went to get our students, medical students in Wuhan.
Right.
It would have been in ordinary times a plain and simple straight operation that you had to fight. You had to file for the flight clearances. It was a military aircraft, so additional clearances are required when you cross the national borders into another country.
Mm-hmm.
Would have required a clearance from the Chinese authorities. Aircraft landed, picked up the cargo, and got it back here.
Mm-hmm.
Here, because there was a total lockdown at that point in time, mm-hmm. it became such a difficult effort to first, and on the other side, China and Wuhan were also in absolute lockdowns.
Yeah.
When the clearances came in from the Chinese side, mm-hmm. after we had given all the necessary medical and the other certificates to them, the aircraft took off from Delhi. That is the time when the students were given the permission to come out of their rooms or houses, wherever they were staying, and make way to the airport. That is also the time when our defense attaché flew in from Beijing to Wuhan to mm-hmm. take of those and put them in the aircraft. We got them back. The amount of effort that one had to make, we could not get that aircraft into the military parking area because mm-hmm. we did not have the other facilities of your immigration, customs, and all, they are not available in the military parking area. Now in COVID times, to get everyone, right from the Home Secretary to the Civil Aviation Secretary, had to be involved in getting the instructions passed, people physically lifted out, got in, people went out of their way to do things, but
mm-hmm.
created so much of complexity. But after one or two flights, we became wiser. And when we got the other flights from Iran and Japan and such like places, then the systems became much more streamlined. But the systems were very, very complex to get so many people to come in together to do a simple job, which in ordinary times, we don't even get to know as to how it happens.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So it was a tremendously complex operation just for one flight, right?
Absolutely.
Whereas before COVID, you would have thousands and ten thousands of flights crisscrossing the skies every day, every hour rather, right? Okay. So just for one flight, you had to, matlab, kitna aapko papad belne pade, right?
Yes.
Okay. Right. Okay. Now the last letter and last word, ambiguity. Anybody would like to take up ambiguity and link it to COVID-19? Okay, let me make your job easier. Link it to the COVID vaccine.
The ambiguity is probably, Dr. Ketan would be a better person to answer, but ambiguity probably in the initial stages refers to the ambiguity of the treatment. No one actually knew as to the treatment as far as the COVID was concerned. Everything was hit and trial.
Mm-hmm.
That was probably the ambiguity till the medical practitioners were able to home on to a general protocol which needed to be followed as far as the management of the patients was concerned, sir.
Right. Okay.
That's the time when we then classified the patients into the three stages. One only required isolation, the others required oxygen support, and the third ones, the third category, were the ones who required extensive intervention as far as aggressive intervention for management of the medical condition was concerned.
Right, right. Okay. Anybody else would like to try?
I would.
Urmashi. Yes, Urmashi.
Hi, sir. Very good afternoon to everyone and to you too. One simple example of ambiguity which I can think of is the guidelines that used to come from state and center regarding the COVID. The way it used to be interpreted became a really difficult task for us. So I am working with a company called TVS, which is into warehousing and logistics. And we were given permissions to operate the essential products, the transportation and warehousing of essential products. So it was really ambiguous because in one territory, in one region, they would have certain set of instructions and rules that were following. While, you know, if you go outside the city limits, there were certain rules that were there. So a kind of very, very ambiguous situation for all of us, what to follow, what not to follow. So that became a challenge.
Somebody else also wanted to say something.
Yeah, this was me, Arvind. Yes, one ambiguity related to COVID vaccine also at the current time is there are so many vaccines which have come up into picture globally.
Yeah.
Each one has a different sort of efficiency or accuracy. So like if you talk about Pfizer, it is like having 95% accuracy, efficiency to treat the virus. And similarly, there are some two vaccines available here in India, one with 81% and one with 65% efficacy. And people are trying to, some of them, they have the opportunity to go and have the vaccine. Some of them, even they have the opportunity to go and have the vaccine, they do not want to, because they do not know if it is actually going to do some harm rather than any good. Because it is not had, we do not actually, were able to give proper time for the clinical trials. So how it is going to affect the life cycle of human being is still uncertain. So it actually becomes very ambiguous whether even if I have the opportunity to go and have the vaccine, should I go and take it or not?
Right.
And if I have to, which vaccine should I take? Because there are so many vaccines.
No, you don't have a choice.
I can go.
whichever vaccine they give you, you don't have a choice. Right. Okay. So
in India, I guess there are two vaccines, you have a choice. In India, there are two vaccines available. You have a choice to choose either of them.
Okay.
Arvind, as of now, the vaccines are not available in open market. So you don't have a choice. When you,
Wherever you register, whichever vaccine they have, you have to take.
Right.
You don't have a choice. Right. Okay. I don't know whether people have come across that video where there's this old man who is who wants to register for a vaccine. And he asked what would the vaccine do to him? And he asked whether I'll be, it'll be okay if I take the vaccine and I don't have to wear mask. They said, no, you'd have to wear the mask. Then he asked whether if everybody is taking the vaccine, then will all the malls open and everything would be normal? They said, no, it won't. If all my family members, we take the vaccine, can we hug each other? This person says no, right? So can it prevent me from dying? He says no. So then finally this guy gets exasperated and says, why am I taking the vaccine in the first place? All right, that was a joke, but it has a lot of truth in it, actually. Everything is ambiguous. Everything is uncertain as far as the vaccination is concerned worldwide, not only in India, worldwide. Even the Pfizer and other vaccines are also equally like that. There's no certainty. There's no certainty as to what the vaccine can do for you. All right. Okay. So in a low volatility situation, it's the if you look at the curve, it's a gentle curve and it's predictable. Whereas if something which is high volatile, there's high volatility, if I can get an example from say share prices movement, right, in times of uncertainty, then your share prices would move with very very high volatility. Whereas when your economy is stable, then the share prices should be much less volatile. Similarly, in low uncertainty situation, like the situation when Sun Tzu lived, or before the 20th century, there was much less uncertainty as to what could happen. Whereas in the 20th century and more so in 21st century, in every sphere, whether it is business or medicine or anything, you have tremendously high uncertainty. Like the things can move in any direction, right? Similarly, in the earlier days, the complexity was much less, because the number of variables were less, right? So now the number of variables are like mind-boggling, right? And also the interconnectivity of the variables is also very high. So that makes our job as managers or organizational leaders much more difficult. Similarly, the last point is, in situations of low ambiguity, it's like looking at an object which in clear daylight, whereas in situations which are highly ambiguous, in the sense, suppose there is a very thick fog, and you can't even see your hand yourself, say two, three feet away. So it's very difficult because the objects which are there within your eyesight, they are the same object, but because of the fog or because of certain situations, it becomes obfuscated, and you are not very sure as to what you are looking at, right? So in that situation, where there is high volatility, you do not know what will happen the next day. There is high uncertainty. There are several different scenarios which can happen, and you can't even predict which way to go. It's like getting into a crossroad which has say 20 different pathways leading on to from that crossroad. So you do not know where to go or which route to take. The high complexity and high ambiguity builds onto the scene, and it just spoils the scene for you, right? You are not no longer sure or secure. So you would actually be envying the person who would be managing an organization in the 19th century. Everything is certain, everything is unambiguous, whereas situations like it's happening now, it actually makes you feel as if you are losing control over yourself. Right. No matter who you are, you may be from Delhi IIT, you may be from IIM or from Harvard, but the situation is such that you have never seen the situation before. Right. So this is the VUCA world we are talking about, and this is the world where we are asked to manage organizations. Now, coming to organization change, if you actually Google the word organization change, then you are actually flooded with so many entries, right? All right. So the word, if you type in organization change, and then you would find actually around 4,700. And this is not Google, right? This is just in Amazon.com, right? So if you just type in the book section, organization change, it just throws up 4,783 results, right? So let's look at. Change management will give you, say, 12,185 results on Amazon. But I'm not talking about even about Google. Organization change will give you on Amazon 100,000 results, right? 1 lakh results. Similarly, change management will give you 10,000 results. Organization development will give you 50,000 results in Amazon. And I'm not even talking about Google. So you can imagine how difficult your job is when you want to know about organization development or change management. Because there are so many theories there. And the experts are also not on the same page as to what organization development means, right? So we will see how we will tackle that problem when we come to it. But the thing at which I'm driving at is that it's not going to be easy for anybody who wants to be an expert on organization development. Change management is easier because it affects a smaller part of the organization rather than the entire. Whereas organization development would be a much tougher nut to crack. Now, what actually spoils the broth is again the fad aspect, which we have already discussed. Right. So your chairman or your CEO reads a book on some new development in the management while he's on a flight from Delhi to Mumbai, and he buys that book, reads it, or maybe just browses through it and calls the HR head like you, and tells him that this is it. I want this concept or this thing to be introduced in my organization, and there you are, right? So it becomes a fad management rather than organizational development, right? So in fact, many of the concepts which we heard in the 70s, 80s, 90s, it started off that way, and gradually it petered out. Like the quality circles, which was huge, humongous in the, it started in the late 70s, and its peak was in the early 80s, and gradually it petered out by the end of, say, the 80s, it just petered out. Although of course there are still quality circles in many organizations, but they are not in that league as they were in the early 80s. Similarly, TQM, once quality circles petered out in the late 80s, the total quality management picked up, right, in the early 90s. And its heydays were in the mid 90s. And again, it did peter out towards the beginning of the new millennium by 2021, it just petered out. Also, BPR, business process reengineering, which started in say 1991, 92, and it saw its stocks rise very high in 1995-96, and again towards the end of the century, last century, it petered out. So this actually is the fad life cycle graph, right? So like you have the quality circles which started and ended early. Then you had the total quality management, world-class manufacturing, WCM, the lean manufacturing, which actually started with Toyota in the early 90s, the Six Sigma, which was actually big towards the end of last century, and it continued for almost 10 years since then. And now not many people are talking about Six Sigma and Lean Sigma. Then Agile, it had a very, very short blip in 2003, 2004. Although the latest, anybody from the IT industry here, IT,
yes?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, sir. I'm also from IT and software services.
All right. Okay. So Agile software development, actually.
Yes.
It had the concept actually had almost gone till the it was revived in the second decade of this century. So this is the this is called the fad life cycle. So is organization development and change management another fad, or there is something to it? I mean, there is some life still left in it. So we will discuss that as we go along in the next six classes. Is it going the same way as, say, TQM or re-engineering or strategic planning, or we are onto something big when we are talking about OD? In fact, OD, although it started somewhere in the 80s, still it has some life left in it. And now that the disruptive technologies have thrown up things like HR analytics, which are cutting edge, they're still in the early stages of their development. So those who expect to specialize in organization development and change management, at least your shelf life will remain. That much I can assure you, your shelf life will remain at least for another 10-15 years. So don't worry, even if you have decided to go in for it, right? Now, one thing we need to guard against, this applies to actually any specialist. Like if you want to be an organization development specialist, it's same as being a ENT specialist or medicine specialist or going in for any, say, psychometric tool, right? Like you certify yourself on, say, DISC profiling, and the whole world looks to you as a DISC, right? So that's what we must guard against. There's a saying that if you all you have in your toolkit is a hammer, everything looks like a nail, right? So depending on which doctor you go to, if you go to a surgeon with a fall, and you go to a surgeon, and the first thing he would tell you is to get a X-ray done, and at the slightest opportunity, and then your X-ray or MRI may be ambiguous, and you would go for surgery because that's what he has been trained for. or if you go to a medicine specialist, no matter what your X-ray or MRI report says, he will give you some medicine. And even if it may require surgery, since he has been trained to be a medicine man, so he would give you a medicine for that, and that's it. So this is something which you must guard against. Like, even if you become a OD specialist, you do not look at the world, all the problems of the world, as a OD problem, right? So it could actually be a solution which would require not a entire organization wide intervention, but it could be a problem which is localized. So instead of suggesting organization wide intervention, which organization development specialists do, you should actually look at things and give a solution which is due to it, rather than from the hat you are wearing, right? So your hat, the OD specialist hat, going forward, if you do become an OD specialist, it should not color your vision as to what kind of solution you want to provide for to the organizational problems. So if you are a hammer, don't look at the world, the entire world, as a nail. Right. That's my suggestion and advice to you in the very first class which we are having today. Okay, so I'll just quickly, because we do have 6 minutes, I'll just quickly introduce you to what change management is and what organizational development is. And it'll be just a superficial definition or an understanding of it, and we will go deeper into it in the subsequent classes, right? So organization development is basically a planned organizational change, right? It's nothing which happens just like that. You need to plan for it, and mostly the organization development interventions come from the initiative of the top management. Although there are some proponents of OD who say that even people at lower levels and people, the groups of people in the organization can actually start OD intervention. But unless it has the support and support of the top management, is not going to, it may see the light of the day, but it's not going to succeed. So somebody who did mention although OD intervention is supposed to be a top management thing, what can the middle management do as far as the OD interventions are concerned? For her, my answer would be that the middle management, they can actually channelize the if it is coming from below, the OD intervention or OD initiative comes from below. It is the role of the middle management to channelize the felt need of the organization, which comes from below, to the top, and convince them for the need for change, for the need for maybe organization-wide change, and play the role of a catalyst, right, to take the intervention forward. And when if it is the other way around, if the initiative comes from the top management, so it is the role of the middle management to disseminate the initiative and make the information available to people down below, and see to it that the intervention is a success by One, disseminating the nitty-gritties of the intervention, and also the execution part. Like it is the whenever OD intervention happens, it is not the top management who would actually go down to the brass tacks and do it. It is the middle management and the people down below who have to do it. So this is the role in OD intervention process. This is the role which the middle management has to play, both ways. Whenever something comes up as a felt need, or whenever something comes up as a top management initiative, they have a very, very important role to play. Now, a planned organization is basically managing the future from the present, right? So it's a very, very simple definition of organization development. Managing the future from the present. Now, how do you know that your future needs any managing at all? How do you know that your future needs a OD intervention for the organization to succeed? So there are basically three reasons or three nudges which actually tells you whether you need a OD intervention at all. The first nudge is for the present. Like if you are finding yourself in hot water, in a soup, then that makes your job very, very urgent. That if you want to retain your market position, if you want to succeed in the future, then you have to handle, first you have to get out of the soup, right? So to get out of the soup, you have to think of ways to get out of the soup. And possibly organization-wide change management or organization-wide OD intervention may help you to get out of the soup. The second nudge, which actually will tell you whether you need a OD intervention, is your experience of the past. So your experience, I mean, there's no guarantee that whatever has happened in the past would span out the same way in the future as well, but it does show the way. So your past experience also will tell you the need for your OD intervention for the future. Then the third notch is that suppose your past is perfect, right? You have a past perfect. Your present is hunky dory, right? Still, do you need a OD intervention? Yes, you do. Because your products and services may be actually giving you returns, and those can be, say, cash cows for you. But every product or every service have their product life cycle or service life cycle. Now, unless you invent a new product or you invent a new service and create a market for it for yourself, then your product will die out, your service will die out. And if you don't have a second product or service to offer to the market, then your organization will also die out, right? So that's the reason why organizations like say Mahindra's, they are tying up with even small startups for electric vehicles. Mahindra's in fact did tie up with small aggregators for providing say commuting services, right? Going forward, people may not actually be buying as many vehicles as they are doing right now, okay? And also once the self-driving cars become a reality, then people will not buy cars anymore. Why should, when milk is available in the market, why would you buy a cow and feed it, right? So if a vehicle can be used 24/7 and without a driver, so why do I need to buy a vehicle, right? In fact, this has already, the trend has already started amongst the millennials. Nobody wants to buy a car. Nobody wants to actually buy even a house, right? So the trend is, the writing is on the wall. So that's the reason why OD intervention for the future is a must. So the cue to OD intervention may come from the present. It can come from the past and it can come from the future as well. All right, so we stop here. And
what was the first point that you had mentioned for the OD change?
First point was present. Okay. Present, yeah. So if your present is not perfect and you find yourself in a soup, yeah. So that would require some intervention, and it could be intervention for a smaller portion of your organization, or it can be organization wide, right? So it can come from the present, from the past, from the for future considerations also. So that's what.
Okay. Right.
Right. Okay. Right, guys. Thank you so very much for joining in. Hopefully, I would see most of you, if not all, in my next class. And I'll share my PPT also. I mean, there's not much to share in this first class. But yeah, going forward, I will be sharing my PPTs. Don't worry. And there are, I think, a couple of readings which has been suggested by the ISTT board. So those two are there on the website, so you can download those and read. There are only two of them. One is on OD and the other is on change management. And going forward, I would also be sharing with you other extra additional reading materials. Okay, right. Thank you, guys. Enjoy the rest of Sunday.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.